So in my project, we are focusing in gene editing for cystic fibrosis and using the recent gene editing technique, the CRISPR-Cas9. So just kind of introduction for that, cystic fibrosis. So cystic fibrosis is one of the common autosomal genetic disease. It's affecting many organs, but it's more lethal. It's when it's involving the lung. So it's caused by a mutation in gene encoding the cystic fibrosis transmembrane conduction regulator. So that gene encoding the CFTR, which is necessary for chloride transport, and that also it's maintaining the water balance above the epithelium cells, which necessary for the cilia beating. So when the mutation happening, the water layer is decreased and the sodium channel is more functional. So it's mucus, it will be accumulate there, and it's making a suitable environment for bacteria for making infection and inflammation. So there is more than 1,000 mutation in cystic fibrosis causing the disease. However, the most common is the ΔF508 mutation. So you can see here's the for ΔF508 mutation, the deletion for CTT, and that making deletion for the phenylalanine at position 508. Unfortunately, there is no effective treatment for most of the patients. So there is approved from FDA. It's a drug for CAFTOR. It's only it's for treatment around 5% of patient. But other patients, there's still some. They don't have an effective treatment. So in this project, we are aiming to potential to see if the CRISPR-Cas9 or as a therapy for cystic fibrosis, and to using the donor template for correction. So for that, we're using the CRISPR-Cas9 system. We targeting the CFTR near from the ΔF508 mutation. We're using the donor template for correction. So it's the we targeting CFB cells, could be cell line or moving later for the primary cells. And later we need to confirm the homologous and non-homologous efficiency and characterizing the correction. To deliver this this system in our lab, we develop nanoparticles. So it's two parts. So it's liposome to encapsulating the CRISPR-Cas9, and it's also the liposome. It's also when we have a neutral lipid, it's enhancing endosomal escaping. The other part, which is also important for our system, it's using a peptide. So the peptide give the more specificity for the nanoparticles. So for targeting the epithelium cells, we are using the peptide E. So moving that to the results. So for CFB's cell line, which has ΔF508 mutation in both allele. So we designed for guide RNAs the most near from the ΔF508 mutation. And we did that. We used the plasmid BX330. So after a few days or 48 hours, we extract the cells. We did the TSF assay. So, however, we couldn't detect any indels. So then we designed other two guide RNA, which is far from ΔF508 mutation, but they seem as they working very well. So the target 5 is making like around 13.5%, whereas the target 6 is making it around 24%. Once we confirm from we are able to make non-homologous recombination and double strand break, we use the homologous recombination. So we use a donor template which has homology versus CFTR, and it has also the puromycin as a selection marker. So also the puromycin selection marker, it has the LOX-B, so we can in future we use it to remove the selection. So once we transfix the cells with the guide RNA in parallel with the donor template, then we use the PCR technique just to confirm if we have the correction happening. So it's like, you know, when we have one PCR on one primer inside the donor template, whereas the other one is outside. So once we confirm we have that 0.9 kb, we start to select the cells with the puromycin. So we use the minimum kill concentration, which was for the CFB minus 41. It was around 2 microgram per ml. Then we start, once the cells they are resistant for puromycin, we start to make a cell clone. When we have enough cells for clone and we have cells they are confluent, so we extract again the DNA and we did another PCR to just to confirm if they have also the integration and homologous recombination. However, this PCR is not enough to confirm that it's happening, it's in the correction in one allele or both alleles. So the other way to do it, doing the PCR, where the both primers is outside the donor template. So if it's happening in both allele, it's meaning we're going to see a big PCR product, which should be around 4.5 kb. What if happening in just one allele, we're going to see two PCR products. One is around 1.9 kb, another one is around 4.5 kb. So then we extract, when we did it in a gel, just this example of one of our clone. So we can see it, there is a, both PCR product, 1.9 and 4.5 kb. When we did the sequence for the upper one, we can see the correction happening. So we can see the CTT coming in the sequence. Moving to the primary cells, which they are more represent, especially when we grow it in air liquid interface at the 3D culture, it's representing the situation in vivo. However, we have kind of limitation. So it's the cells, they are not like the cell line. They are more difficult for transfection. So when we transfect them with the plasmid, express the GFB to see how they are, so it's a percent of only have 10% of the cells they are able to uptake and express the GFB. So then we try to use other system for transfection, is the mRNA. And when we did it with a different combination of our nanoparticles, we see that when you use the C18, which is the dotmadob with the peptide E, giving the highest expression is almost 60%. So we use the mRNA as a Cas9 and the guide RNA as by in vitro transcription. However, still the non-homologous recombination still is quite low. So I think we need to do more optimization, maybe by using a protein or to find the optimal way for transfection. Then when we did the homologous recombination by using the donor tablet, also we can detect the 0.9 kb, it's meaning the homologous recombination happening. So we are now in the stage we need to clone these cells and making a clone. Then we'll, because they are primary cells, we can do a lot of functional assay for them. So by electrophysiology when they are on air liquid interface, or we can measure the ASL depth for the water layer, because it's we restore the functional. And we can also measure the mucociliary clearance. And the other way we can also confirm by Western plot to see if the, because the Delta 508 mutations only have the B band, but the wild type is going to have both band. So to summary what I did, it just we start by guide RNA designing for Delta 508 mutation, and we are able to make the double strand break and making the homologous recombination. It's now we are more for more optimization, and we hope that will be going to be soon. Finally, I would like to thank my supervisor, Steve Hart, and Chris Oakland, and other colleagues from our lab, and for my sponsor for funding me for my PhD. And I'll be happy for answer question. Thank you.